Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?
Hello, my name is Steve Ulrichs and welcome to my world. Actually, it's not my world, it's the world of Charlie Hodge. In March 1995, I had the privilege to meet Charlie Hodge and spend some days with him while he was in Denmark. Charlie was a very funny guy. You'll hear that a little bit in this interview, but you'll also see it on some of my other video clips. So far, have a good time with Charlie Hodge for the next half hour. Welcome to my world.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?
And so we became friends on that voyage. I was up here hunting today. They did it like it was a maneuver, military maneuver, sailing straight over from New Jersey to Rapid Air. We did a like a wartime zigzag here, and it took several days. And then I was stationed in Kurzgoins, Germany, and he was in Freiburg or Freiburg, however you pronounce it. But that was only like, I was only 15 or 20 kilometers from where he was. Because he was living in Bad Nauheim. Freiburg, I think, is like the suburbs of Bad Nauheim. So I would come to his house and ask him, it's going to be So our friendship just grew. And we began to sing with each other and sang a duet. And so it began there. And after the military, my quartet had broken up because without me, they didn't have an act. And the national TV show was on, had gone off the air. The Army's supposed to get you your job back. They already got out there. What are they going to get me? A couple didn't show in their quartet? I said, sorry. So Elvis had talked to me about going to work for him. And so I went back home to Alabama. And then I drove up because he wanted me to go to Nashville with him. And I didn't understand why. And then he told me, he said, I want us to record a duet, Regions to Sing together a lot in Germany while I will be home again. And so that was the first time he'd ever cut a duet, a complete duet with him. And then later on we did other duets, like the title song of his first all gospel album. It's called His Hand in Mine. And that's how it's not singing. Then later on, when he did How Great Thou Art, which became his most famous gospel song, I did the arrangement on that. There was a hit arrangement on the session. I said, how are we going to do this number? And I said, why don't we do it like this? And so it's my arrangement.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in? To my world, won't you come on in?
Well, it was everything was normal. We knew Elvis was sick. None of us knew how sick. We knew that he had. He was taking prescription drugs for things that was wrong with him. He had hypertension. And he had to fly home.
Legal man.
Yeah. He had to take his drug and gone blind.
He had a
bad liver, just like his mother. Yeah. And we didn't know that Elvis had a bad heart, because she never knew that. Yeah. And a doctor doesn't check for the heart unless you can find it. Yeah. So Elvis never knew that. And they discovered during the autopsy the left side of his heart was twice as large as the right side. And also that he had discovered he had had 3 heart attacks already and didn't know it. So those weakened valves were all over there. So when he crossed over, he crossed over his heart. They said if the medical team that came there said if they'd had all the right equipment there, but the moment they got found it, it was too late. But see, he died of the same things that his mother died of. And by central, now, what people don't know either is her 2 brothers died the same way. And they were all enlarged. The body was enlarged when they died. So it was actually a hereditary thing on the Smith side of the family to die younger. But that doesn't self-answer. The magic word, drug. But they never specified and say what drugs and what the drugs are for. They just use the one phrase, drugs. And everybody thinks street drugs. Never street drugs, prescription drugs. And yes, they were necessary. He had a twisted colon. It was very, very painful. And he had to take a heavy narcotic for that. So yes, he was addicted to that. But it was necessary. They never have said that anything was necessary, yet it was. And of all the drugs found in his name, they said many, many drugs in his name. That's true. But then they don't tell you the rest of the story. They don't tell you that whole year. See, the rest of the story is Dr. McCombs. His doctor was not only his doctor, my doctor. He was our tour doctor. And we had 84 people on the tour. So he had to carry the drugs that he might need. It might become necessary on the road, like headache. If you got 84 people, you don't get a 10 of aspirin. You get a big bottle of aspirin. Well, same for pain pills. Blood pressure pills. Everything that possibly might be. Well, in other states, he was only licensed in the state of Tennessee. So he couldn't write prescriptions for those drugs in other states. So he had to carry with him what he might need. And they were in Elvis's name so they could be attached by all of them. See, now it all makes sense. See, now it all makes sense, but they don't tell you the word. Because they only use the one magic word, drugs. And that is like imagination to the rest of them. And he wasn't into street drugs. He couldn't smoke marijuana. He didn't know how to inhale. He didn't smoke cigarettes, he smoked cigars. And you don't inhale a cigar. So he could smoke marijuana, he didn't know how to inhale. So what drugs could he have been doing? You know? I mean, he didn't need cocaine because of the pain that he had with his twisted colon, there was already that medicine in his medicine room. But what was wrong with him, see? So what he took was necessary. And yes, he was addicted because it was necessary. He couldn't help it. If you had the same problems, you would have to be addicted or die. You know? So what would you choose to do, to be addicted or to die? See? See, it makes sense when you tell the whole story. I was one of the fallbacks. What I did is, I think 8. Because it was a very heavy problem. Made out of copper. You know, it was very, very good. His mother was, they had the same type of copper his mother was very good. It was very expensive and heavy. And then they put him in a vault that all the way over 4,000 pounds. And they put him in the grave of Graceland. The casket was put inside the vault. And then the vault was put over there and sealed. So the casket, which is copper, is sealed. The vault was sealed. So no one could ever see I think you would notice the truck more than that. But I was there. I helped work on his body. Because he was covered up his body. And Joe Esposito and Al Estrada were working on the body. When I went upstairs with Mr. Presley, his father, and his cousin, who was his secretary, and Mr. Presley's secretary. And I found out the same thing I did, which I didn't know. And when they were upstairs, I saw they were crying, and I knew something was wrong. So I went up and went in there, it was Joe and Al Estrada trying to get him to breathe. Rigor mortis had already said, here, it's hard to run. He'd been lying there, they found him about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and they think he died somewhere about 10 o'clock in the afternoon. So he'd been lying there for 4 hours. But we continued to try to make him breathe, in his mouth, resuscitation, everything. I mean, the medics, when they got there, they saw his condition. They just let us alone. And then Dr. Papadopoulos came there, and we all went in the hospital. His hairbrush trimmed his hair, and then I trimmed his sideburns, and then I styled his hair, because I used to wash his hair and dry it, and I would do it on stage, and styled his hair, because he once said, I remember he once said when we were in Las Vegas, and we had a friend who had this advice, someone sort of shooting from the audience. He said, I hope they don't kill me in the face, because I would like to look as much like myself in my coffin. With that in mind, I went up there and made sure his hair was perfect and everything so he could look like he wanted to be. So it got 3 days for him. So I had worked on his body before they dressed him to put him in the coffin. And then I told the lady how to do his makeup. Because his makeup, you know, they had to use makeup on his body for some discoloring. And I told the lady how to do his makeup. That's the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. But he was my friend. And he was the best friend. He was the best friend I believe I could ever have had. He was like a brother. See, I lived in Graceland, in his home, for 17 years. And all of his rooms, all of his homes, in Palm Springs, California, Hollywood, Memphis, there was one room that's called Charlie's Room. They get a new home. They got a new home in Priscilla. It took a year to decorate the new home. My bedroom was next to their bedroom. And decorated in my favorite colors because it's just what's accepted. Charlie's going to be living in the room. I was like family. See, so he was like a brother.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?
Very much so, yeah. If Elvis was, he loved his employees, the ones that were food. He didn't realize certain things were going on, like with people's expenses, like your expenses, my expenses. He wasn't aware of those, but said he was taken care of for him. And once, when all the guys, and they had their families, and some of the guys were married, so they had to keep two homes and keep one of them. And they went to Elvis and said, Elvis, we can't exist like this because we're having to keep two homes when there's one here on the side of the land. And Elvis got angry and said, well, if you don't tell me these things, I can't do anything about it. And he got mad, and then he went to his room and he wept. Because he didn't know that he was suffering this uncomfortable situation. So he raised everybody. That's when he started paying really very good salaries for them. So they afforded him a home in both places. Now people, I've got, over the years, I received several cars. Over the year, the first car I was staying here, Joe Esposito, who was like his roadrunner, had a 1951 MG, which I wish I had today. And he was selling it, and he said, Charlie, you don't have a car, do you? And I said, no. He said, Joe, I think I'll buy you a car. I said, okay. Joe signed the things before with me, and I put it in my name. I don't think he ever paid Joe for the car. He forgot about it. And Joe wouldn't ask him. And then he gave me a 1970, well, no, he gave me a 1964 Cadillac in 1967. Then in 1971, I had a, well, in 1966, I had a brand new Mustang Fastback. But he wanted me to have a Cadillac, so he found a 64 convertible. He wanted all the guys to have a convertible Cadillac. He said, most of the time when you see a guy who's got a convertible, so he's 65 years old and bald. He said, the guy should have a car when he's young and he has a So we had, you can picture this, we go to Palm Springs with 12 or 14 Cadillacs convertible. And we cover all three lanes in rows and stacks going to Palm Springs. 12 or 14 Cadillac convertibles, so young men going to Palm Springs. So it was fun. And then in 71, I can give you a brand new 1971 280 SL Mercedes Benz. In 1973, you gave me a brand new 450 SL Mercedes Benz. In 1977, gave me a brand new Cadillac Seville. And I still have that Cadillac. I may sell it though, but I've been offered, one person offered me £35,000 for that Cadillac, and I may sell it. I have three guitars he gave me, and they're all rare. Two of them I'll sell, one I will keep for myself. And Colonel Parker always said, if you don't want to sell something, you put such a price on it, no one can afford it. So I have a little black Gibson guitar that was made in the 40s that I played on this 68 comeback and also the Aloha from Hawaii. I used it on stage before. Mm-hmm. And after the Aloha from Hawaii show, I retired the guitar. Because I figured it did a show for the world, it did enough. But he gave me two Martins, an 016 Martin and an 018 Martin, which are rare. You can find a lot of 00-16s and 18s, a lot of 00-16s and 18s, but not many single 00-16s. And I played those on stage a lot. I've been offered $125,000 a piece for the Martin, which I would sell if someone brings me the cash. I won't let them make payments like on a car. Anyways, I'm not in the banking business. So. And, but my little black Gibson guitar that was made in the 40s, one I used on the Aloha from Hawaii and the 68 comeback, I won't sell it. So I put a price on it of $5 million. But if somebody comes up with $5 million, I have to sell it. Because if I don't, Elvis will come back and ask me to bend over and show me what he thinks of me, and I'll take it to $5 million.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?